Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Bring your wig on, hold dear.
Now is at stake, now is at stake.
Humbling your heart to God, say to the chasing rod, take the way, feel it, pilgrim's stride, grace is away. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet there too, trumpets will sound. All of the dead
shall rise,
righteous beings in the skies, going where no one will die, heavenward bound. Troubles will soon see or happy forevermore, when we meet on that shore, freedom again. Rising up in the sky,
telling his goodbye,
homeward with them we will fly, glory to share. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will be there too. Trumpets will sound. All of the
dead shall rise.
Righteous beings in the skies. Going where no one dies. Heavenward bound. Be seated.
Well, good morning. If you're visiting with us this morning, a special good morning. Note, there's a little card there in front. It says, welcome visitor. If you put your phone number on there, we'll put you on the automated call list and call you with that same number every hour on the hour at dinner time. No. But there is a nice little lady who would love to send you a little card just to say thank you for joining us. And, of course, you're welcome to be with us anytime. I guess we're entering into another period of unknown. So for those of you who braved and decided to come and be here, welcome. And for those of you who stayed at home and you're going to watch it through the video, let's be grateful for those men that put that together. They probably deserve a... Because I don't think we can say that enough, that it's not a trivial task. And it just reminds us that in these crazy times we live, there's also a time of blessing as well, right? That we can be together even when we're not together. So let's say a quick prayer, and let's just get started this morning. Let's try to focus on whatever you're thinking about, the thing you messed up last week, or the thing you're going to mess up next week. We'll just try to push those aside for a bit and let this moment in between be God's moment, right? Where we can just focus on His awe and His greatness and remember why we're here and why we gather, all right? Lord, we just come to you this morning. We just ask that the folks that are gathered here, may we find ourselves in a place of oneness where we remember that it's your hand that governs all things. As the world sways this way and the world sways that way, may we remember that you're right in the middle, you're in control. And that if there's one thing that the letters of the law and the books of the Old Testament taught us, that no matter who's in charge, Lord, it is you and your plan that will prevail no matter what. Lord, we ask that you would be with our leaders of this country and that the leaders of our school districts, the leaders of this congregation. And I would ask for all of us to have a special layer of understanding to know that in this time we're in, that everything has polarized so many people so many different ways that no matter what choice most of our leaders make, they are going to upset at least half of the population. So with that heavy heart that they have to enter into, please let your wisdom be their guide. But as us who are trying to respond, please let us have a heart of forgiveness and a heart of understanding. And Lord, let that critical thinking be in our heart and our mind. Please let us understand that that there are very few good decisions right now, and that we just want to do the best we can. Be with us as we sing our songs. May our voice be lifted up. May your ears be pleased. May it be your ears that our goal is to blast a roost off this place. Whether we've got 5 or 500, Lord, let us sing as though we are millions. For it is in your Son's name that we come and we give thanks for this time to gather. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Lord, I give myself to thee, thine forevermore to be. Lord, I give my life to thee, thine forevermore for thee. Take my love, my Lord, I pour at thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Lord, I give myself to thee, thine forevermore to be. Lord, I give my life to thee, thine forevermore to be. Purer in heart, O God, help me to be. May I devote my life wholly to thee. Wash thou my wayward feet. Guide me with counsel sweet. Purer in heart, help me to be. Purer in heart, O God, help me to be.
Would you join me in prayer? Holy Father, we praise your name above all else. Father, we come before your mighty throne in prayer this morning, praying for our nation, praying for our world. Help us to be pure in heart each day, that we might be drawn closer to your will. Father, we have many of our number that are sick, many who have friends and relatives who are sick, many who have passed away. We pray for all these. We pray for those who are lonely, for those who mourn this morning. Father, we pray for the families of the servicemen who gave their lives for our country in Afghanistan. We pray for those who might be left behind. Father, if it's your will, may they all be rescued. Father, we pray this morning for Joe as he brings a message from your holy word. We pray for our elders, for our deacons, for Ray Don, for Alan, and the work that they all do. We thank you, Father, for the love that permeates this congregation. These people that are yours only. Father, we ask that everything we do and say this morning will be in accordance with your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You were despised, you were rejected, Lord, those who passed by. Even averted their gaze from the sight. Such was the suffering you bore for us. Led like a lamb to the slaughter, you spoke not a word, but chose to be silent, though you did no wrong, nor was deceitfulness found. Suffering our freedom is won. For God has highly exalted your name. He has enthroned you on high. Jesus, the name above all names. God has highly exalted your name. He has enthroned you on high. Jesus, the name above all names. You were despised, you were rejected, Lord, though you passed by. Even averted their gaze from the sight. Such was the suffering you bore for us. Led like a lamb to the slaughter, you spoke not a word, but chose to be silent, though you did no wrong, nor was deceitfulness found in you. Yet by your words our salvation has come, yet by your suffering our freedom is won. For God has highly exalted your name. He has enthroned you on high. Jesus, the name above all names. God has highly exalted your name. He has enthroned you on high. Jesus, the name above all names. You were despised, you were rejected, Lord, those who passed by. Even averted their gaze from the sight. Such was the suffering you bore.
do this, but this is our time to come together as a family to partake of the Lord's Supper, to remember the sacrifice that was made for us. And, every Sunday I kind of have my routine, and I think I've mentioned this before, but and maybe a lot of us do have a routine, a little different thing that we do here, but every time, it seems like every Sunday, I catch myself, and I'm ashamed to say this, but I catch myself realizing, wow, I think this is the only time this week that I have thought about this, that I have reflected on that sacrifice and what has been done for me, and what I should do with that, how I should try to live my life constantly remembering that and being thankful for that and living my life a certain way in an attempt to live a life that is worthy of the sacrifices that have been made for me. And maybe I'm the only one, but I don't think that I'm the only one that does that from time to time. And I would just encourage of us, obviously it's easy for us to do this now because this is what we're focused on. This is what this is our time to do this together as a family. But I would just encourage all of us to daily remember the sacrifices that have been made for us. Remember how difficult it must have been for our God to send His one and only Son to die for us. And daily remember just what that sacrifice means for us, the forgiveness of our sins. And that should hit home for all of us, because we know how often we all fall short and how many mistakes we made. Just like Roger said, we know they're coming this next week. We know they are. We know how many times we fell short this past week. So we know just how important that forgiveness of sins is. And also it's that hope of heaven that we have now because of that sacrifice that was made for us. So daily, let's think about this and reflect on this and remember this and live our lives according to that memory and that reflection. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this day and every day that You bless us with. We're especially thankful for this time now that we have to reflect on all that You have done for us, and especially the fact that You gave Your one and only Son to die for us. And so now, Heavenly Father, we're mindful of His body on that cross, how broken it already was at that time because what He had been through leading up to that time on the cross, and especially that those hours on that cross in excruciating pain and discomfort in ways that we can't even really comprehend totally. So we're mindful of that body, and we're thankful that He willingly gave up His body to be hung on that cross for us. So as we partake of this bread together, please help us to remember that sacrifice and remember how significant it was and still is today and always will be for the rest of our lives. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Let's pray again. And now, Heavenly Father, we focus on the blood. We remember this blood that was spilt while on the cross and before the cross, with the beating that He took, the crown of thorns placed upon His head. So much blood. And it was so absolutely necessary, because we know this blood is what it took and what it takes to provide that forgiveness of our sins. So again, when we think about the pain and the torture, it's so heavy on our hearts. It's so hard to realize what all he went through for us. But again, we're so very thankful that he willingly did it and that you willingly sent him to do it. Because we know otherwise we would have no hope whatsoever of having our sins forgiven and having the hope of heaven. So again, thank you. And again, it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. We've done this song before several times, and Bob worked on it and worked on it. This is a hard song. The timing on this song is so hard. So it's 8:03, isn't it? So I'm going to do my best too. I'm always nervous doing this song too, but we'll get through this together. It's a beautiful, beautiful song.
Turn my heart, O Lord. like rivers of water. Turn my heart, O Lord, by your hand, till my whole life flows in the river of your Spirit, and my name brings honor to the land. Turn my heart, O Lord, like rivers of water. Turn my heart, O Lord, by your Spirit, and my name brings honor to the Lamb. Lord, I surrender to your work in me. I rest my life within your loving hands. Turn my heart, O Lord, like rivers of water. Turn my heart, O Lord, by your hand, till my flows in the river of your Spirit, and my name brings honor to the Lamb.
Good morning. You just saw one of the reasons why I appreciate Radon so much and his heart, because he's not going to tell you this, but I'll tell you, every single thing he did this morning, he did as a volunteer up here. He was not scheduled to do any of those three things. So that's just who he is and what he does. When he's needed, he steps up. So I appreciate that. And the communion thought was spot on. I couldn't do that well preparing for something as he did just off the cuff. So appreciate that very much. In a conversation Roger and I had during the class hour this morning, I was reminded again about my old elder at the Georgetown Church. He remembers him as well, J.D. Thomas. And I said, and I think I remember mentioned this in my sermon on Habakkuk a few weeks ago, but every Sunday morning, if J.D. was leading, he would lead the song, "The Lord is in His holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before Him." Keep silence, keep silence. Let all the earth keep silence before Him. That's from Habakkuk chapter 2, which in the prophet's context, he's talking about God is on His throne. And He is in control. All appearances, perhaps, sometimes to the contrary. And you know that expression that we have, God's on His throne and all's right with the world? I'd like to change that, reframe that a little bit, because a more truthful expression is, God is on His throne, and it doesn't matter that all is not right with the world. Amen? Because that doesn't change the fact that He is on His throne. He is in control. He is reigning. Doesn't matter how things look to us on the outside. We need to keep that in mind. We need to take that truth, that reality to heart, and live like we believe those words. Well, Jeremiah 31 is one of our texts, if you want to turn there, and I'll have it on the screen here in just a moment. But as the story goes this morning, renowned child psychiatrist Robert Coles had an encounter with a therapist friend of his one day who confided with him in despair. He said, "I've been doing therapy with this particular man for 15 years. He's just as angry and self-centered and as mean as he was the first day he walked in my office. The only difference now is he knows why he's so angry and mean." And Dr. Coles pointed out that although this doctor friend of his had provided his client with insight as to what child trauma had done to him and how it was affecting his adult dysfunction, the man still hadn't changed. And then he asked, "Could we conclude," this is what Cole said, "could we conclude that what this man needed wasn't just information, but transformation?" And when I read that story, I thought, wow, how timely is that soundbite right now? In an age when our culture is in a permanent state of information overload, wouldn't you agree? We've got way too much information out there for people's good. We don't need more information. We need transformation. It does absolutely no good to try and legislate morality or ethics if only imposed externally from the outside in. The life God wants people to live before Him can only be motivated from the inside. It starts on the inside and works its way out in how the person decides to live with the proper internal motivation. Today, in our text, we're going to look at the Old Testament version and the New Testament version, because it's copied word for word in the New Testament. We're going to see how great and gracious our God is. And this is so like Him in every way. What I'm getting to is we're following right on in our chronological readings, right on where we were last week. We were in Ezekiel chapters 10 and 11. So following chronologically, I know not the way it is in your Bible, but chronologically, we're following right from where we were in Ezekiel last week, where Judah and Jerusalem, you remember, are posed on the edge of destruction, God has said, for their sins. And where you remember, He's about to remove His presence and His glory from them. In fact, it's leaving, in the process of leaving the temple last week in Ezekiel 10 and 11. Though He's always present with His faithful remnant, whether in Babylon or wherever they might be. But we move from that scene in Ezekiel 10 and 11 back to the scene in real time in Jerusalem today in Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah and Ezekiel were contemporaries for some of the time period. Their ministries overlapped. Though Ezekiel's work was always in Babylon and Jeremiah in Judah. But here God already reveals, for the first time in the Old Testament, He reveals at this time what He's been planning all along. What would one day be the new and permanent covenant or testament with His people, which would be a wholly different covenant in nature and quality from the first. So I want us to read these words together, these words of hope, these words of promise that He's delivering right when the people are about to come to an end of what life as they know it. God picks that moment to give them these words from the prophet. And it's in Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through 34. We're going to talk about how revolutionary this word from God was and its relevance for us today. Boy, that's almost too small for me. "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant that I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they'll all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Let me tell you, these are hands down the most important words of all of Jeremiah's prophecies, of all his prophetic work, because they tell first Judah and now us today how God planned all along to fix what was wrong with the old covenant. They will be repeated word for word and reappropriated for the Christian age in Hebrews 8 through 12. And I'm going to put, just for reference sake, for the next few minutes, have that on the screen, verses 10 through 12, and you'll see it's a word-for-word copy of what Jeremiah said. Now, I said something just then that raises questions always with people, especially people who aren't necessarily believers in God. I said God planned to fix what was wrong with the old covenant. Now, some might be quick to ask, well, does that mean in some form or fashion that God messed up? That God failed somehow? Because that's the direction a lot of people think when they hear a sentence like that. No way. No failure on God's part. Well, then the next question, if it's not God, the next question is, well, did the old covenant fail somehow? The old law. Again, no. The law didn't fail either. In fact, Paul goes into this long exposition to the Romans in Romans chapter 7 to say that God's law was holy. It was righteous. It was good. That's just a quick summary statement from Romans 7, 7 through 20. He said the law is what showed God's people how they need to be His people, how they need to live before Him. It set up the guardrails, if you will, the boundary lines in directing how we are to live morally and ethically before Him. Told them what they need to be pleasing to Him if they follow that. That goes back to the original premise I started with today. The old law and covenant provided a lot of information, but it could never affect transformation. Okay, so for the third time, if the failure wasn't with God, it wasn't with the covenant that He first set up at Sinai, then what was the problem? Why was God going to replace it? The failure was totally, completely with the ones, the people with whom God made that covenant in the first place, His people. Because you read it there in the text, they didn't keep it. They failed to be the people He wanted them to be. That was the only place where failure happened. It was the people, not anything else. It was their stubbornness, their rebellion, their willful disobedience to the law that caused it to need to be replaced. It was no fault of God's ability, but totally their inability to keep the law that was written on tablets of stone and on animal skins later, informing how to impose morality externally from the outside in, which would never work. And by the way, before you listen to those who are unbelievers, again, in God in the first place, who will look at this and they'll say, well, when God saw His original plan didn't work, He came up with plan B. Wrong. You're wrong again. Wrong answer. Now make no mistake, this new covenant was to be different in quality and kind and new certainly to the experience of the people, but to God it was all part of His long-range plan that He set in motion before time as we know it began. God doesn't have a plan B. It's all been plan A from the very beginning, from before the beginning, if you want to put it that way. Paul would make this plain to the Galatians when he told them in chapter 3, verse 24 of his letter, that the old covenant, the old law, was intended to be a schoolmaster, the old translations say, or supervisor to bring them to Christ. That was the function of the old law, to bring them up to the point of Christ's death on the cross. Now he uses, Paul does, an interesting word there that sometimes translates schoolmaster, sometimes supervisor. In the Greek, it really meant custodian, not a janitor kind of custodian, but one who had charge of the kids in a Roman home. And the one who had charge of kids in a Roman home was like the kind of like the bus driver today. He's the one that made sure the kids got to school. Okay? So Paul says the law was not, there was not a problem with the law. It was the supervisor to get the kids to where they need to be to the time of Christ. To prepare the way. And so that's what the law was, to lead God's people to what God had intended all along, the new and better way. I like how the NIV Application Bible, little note on that text, 3:24, puts it. We're no longer in need of that kind of supervision. The law teaches us the need for salvation. God's grace gives us that salvation. The Old Testament still applies to us today, because it reveals to us who God is, His nature, His will, and His moral laws by which we are required to live. But we can't be saved by keeping those laws. We're not justified by keeping the law, the old law. We have to trust in Christ for our salvation. And I would add, we have to accept the terms that are part of a new covenant testament, which was ratified, put into effect in Jesus' atoning death for us on the cross. Let me take just an aside here for a moment, because we need to talk about the true idea of this word covenant between God and man to get the full implications of it. I love what William Barclay says. If you've ever seen the little William Barclay, I think they're called daily Bible study commentaries. But look at the one on this passage in Hebrews 8, which is the exact copy of Jeremiah 31:31-34. And he has a fantastic piece on this idea of covenant in his comments on that text. He points out the obvious differences between the kind of covenants, agreements rather, we make with each other and this covenant that God made with his people. There's a vast difference. The agreements we make with each other that were pointed to in Scripture, the Greek word for them was syntheke, means soon is the Greek word for together, meaning there's give and take on both sides. Both sides set some terms, and we mutually agree to the terms we both set, right? When we come to a covenant, an agreement. That's not the way of the covenant between God and His people. It's called diatheke. It's a one-way deal. He sets the terms. And we just have to agree to them. We agree or we don't agree. We make the decision, but He sets the terms. It's compared to a will and testament, this covenant that God's made with His people. And it's called that in one place or another in the New Testament. That's why we have the words Old Testament, that's another word for covenant, and New Testament. The testator, the one who draws up the will, he takes all the initiatives. He sets the terms. The one who's to receive the inheritance has to either meets the testator's terms or else he doesn't get the inheritance. It's that simple. It is that simple. Notice again the initiatives God would take and does take in this new covenant. Repeatedly He says, I will. He says, I will make a new covenant. This is the covenant I will make. I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God. I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. The point is, the successful execution of this new covenant rests not in any one of us, for it to go, for it to be successful, or even all of us collectively. It all depends solely on God. It will never need to be replaced again, because this is the one for which we were intended all along. Let's finish quickly by looking at ways in which this new covenant is so qualitatively better than the old. Number one, at the heart of it is the difference I've been harping on from the outset. It's not physical or sacrificial anymore. Praise God for that, that we don't have to do sacrifices. Is anybody with me on that? Yeah, okay. I'm just seeing if you're still tracking with me. We are so thankful that we don't have that kind of covenant now, but it is inward and it is spiritual in nature. That's one thing for which we can praise God. He says, I'll put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. In the old covenant, the only loyalty, or motivation rather, for loyalty or obedience was what? It was fear of punishment. Fear of judgment if they didn't stick to the stipulations of the covenant. That was it. Now, any real parent that's worth anything as a parent knows this. Would you rather have your children obey out of fear of punishment or out of a motivation of love and respect and honor? That's a no-brainer. We don't want our kids to be in a relationship with us of always fearing what's the next step. When's the next shoe going to drop? You know, what's the next reprisal that's coming my way? That's no relationship to have. And it's the same with God. It's much more enjoyable to get a child to obey because they want to out of love rather than because they're afraid of consequences. To have the law now written on our hearts means we now have the will from the inside to obey it, to do it, which has not been there in the old. That motivation that's the crowning motivation, love, honor, respect, it hasn't as much been there. A couple of texts where this is spoken about. In Deuteronomy, Moses said this, the word is very near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart so that you can do it. Because it's on the inside, you can make that happen more easily, more readily. Ezekiel says this, and again, he's tracking, he's in Babylon, but he's tracking with what Jeremiah is saying here in Judah and Jerusalem. He says, I will give them singleness of heart and put a new spirit within them. I'll take away their stony, stubborn heart and give them a tender, responsive heart so they'll obey my decrees and regulations. Then they'll truly be my people and I will be their God. Well, secondly, I'm so glad that this covenant is one which in which barriers are broken down because it's both individual and universal. What I mean by that is God's laws are written within, then an intimate personal knowledge is implied for every individual, with God being the teacher. Under the old code, not nearly every person, every common ordinary Israelite or Jew knew in detail the law. No one but a trained expert, at least it became that way. May not have started that way, but it became that way. No one but a trained expert or scribe by the time of Jesus' day could know all the endless minutiae of regulations concerning the offerings and sacrifices, just for one example. But under the new covenant, the knowledge of divine matters would not be a private possession of a particular class or group. No longer would there be a distinction between clergy and laity. Knowledge of God is accessible to all alike, regardless of status or standing. All will know the Lord, he says. And I'll add this quickly. That expression, all will know the Lord, is a Hebraism, again, for knowing and doing, obeying his will and his way. To know God, to love him, is to do what he says. Again, it's that simple. And then finally, I still haven't mentioned the key part of this new covenant. And this is what was missing in the old law, the old covenant. that's so phenomenal for us. It is a covenant of grace. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. That little word "for" is huge here because it shows forgiveness of sins is the basis for all the blessings in the new covenant. In other words, they all hang on the fact that now in Christ there is forgiveness. Before, it wasn't present. Sins were kind of put to the side. You know, when someone made sacrifice for it, when the priest made sacrifice for you, it wasn't put away totally. There was no forgiveness. It was just kind of put over here for a time. Or some use the old expression, rolled forward, so to speak, until the time of Christ. But this is the heart of it. This is the fundamental thing that was lacking. Notice what the Hebrews writer says in chapter 10. For the law, since it's only a shadow of the good things to come and not the very form of things, can never, by the same sacrifices which are offered continually year by year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, why wouldn't they have ceased to be offered? Because the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have consciousness of sins. And yet, that's not what happened under the old law. The blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sins. It only reminds people of their sins from one year to the next. And what a great word as we continue to read, and I didn't put it all on the screen, but there in Hebrews 10, beyond that verse, it says, therefore, when Christ came into the world, verse 5, he said, sacrifices and offerings you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings you were not pleased. And then I said, here I am, it's written about me in the scroll, I've come to do your will, O God. He says, verse 10, and by that will we've been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. No real purity of heart and life could be effectual under the old covenant because religion was separated from life, really, in the lives of so many people. A man can have it all together, physically speaking, be circumcised, have all the sacrifices done on a regular basis. He could have all his boxes checked. And that's the problem, again, with a ritualistic, legalistic type religion, isn't it? It becomes a checklist. Okay, I've done this week. I've done this. I'm taken care of. I've taken care of all my obligations so I can go out from the worship place, whatever setting that is, and live like I want to with the rest of my week. It's mine. The new covenant changes that. The new covenant brings all of life together, that it's all belongs to God. It's not just ceremony and then you go and do what you want to do. Religion in the old law was a very artificial thing. But instead of that reminder of sin year after year that came into the old, God puts them away, puts our sins away for good. Now, we have a problem with this concept, don't we? We have this expression, I'll forgive, but I'm not going to forget. Right? I'm making a list. I'm making a record of people who wronged me. The reality here is not in these words, God will forgive our sins and remember them no more. It's not saying he has a faltering memory. You know, he's not old and losing his senses. Rather, it means that because of the saving blood of Jesus in which we were washed clean at our baptism, that line, he'll remember their sins no more, means that they're no longer held to our charge. They're put away as if they never happened. They don't exist in his mind anymore because of Jesus carrying them to the cross. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And so we praise God today because it's just like him, that even as he was preparing to punish his people for their disobedience and sin, he was also almost in the same moment giving them hope that the best was yet to come. That when time was just exactly right, he would usher out the old and he would bring in the new with all its attendant blessings and benefits, enacted, ratified at the moment of Jesus' death, but ever working itself out then in our lives as we walk in step with the empowering presence of his Spirit, who now helps us know him and obey him from the heart. It's all because of his amazing grace, his initiative in making the offer and setting the terms. We just need to take him up on it. And my prayer is, your prayer should be, that we all have taken him up on that freely made offer. And we would understand then and live out the implications of the new and the blessings of the new that we come to in Jesus. Let's, as we stand and sing together, let's sing about that grace that abounds for us.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
Be seated, please.
Good morning. Good morning. It's great to be here, let me assure you. I spent this past week in Arkansas, I guess Monday through Friday, and saw most of my family scattered all over the country who gathered there in Northwest Arkansas. And that's a different place, and particularly being away from all the things that were happening here. I found myself more active and I guess more worn out every day because of all the kids and all the activities. But I'm glad to be back. It was about Wednesday, maybe Thursday, that I got word of some concern, greater concern here at home, about the COVID virus. And I wanted to share some comments with you this morning. I really don't want to talk about the virus. I think we hear enough about that. What I want to talk about, I guess, is being the church that the Lord established and called us to be members of, and particularly to love one another beyond imagination, and to be considerate of one another, to love one another. For the past 18 months, we've all been bothered by what we've come to know as the pandemic. We've also had and shared in the emotional stress, I'll call it, or the anxiety, the frustration, anger, but even fear of all that was going on. And all around us, there's this spirit of debating and division because something is not certain, it's not agreed upon. This church has survived for the most part, I think, because we have continued to be mindful of our calling to love one another, to reach out to one another, to help one another. And rather than to dwell upon what's been going on as a bad thing, could we see this as an opportunity to really prove what we are, to show others what we are, who we believe, and our commitment to the God in heaven? Mixed feelings I have, and perhaps I tend to wander when I get into these things, but we had a time, I can't recall now the date, we've enjoyed for a time liberties. We had initially restrictions, not all of which we enjoyed and appreciated. You've heard some of those discussions. But we've enjoyed for a time some liberties. And believe me, no one wants to go back to that time of great restrictions. But we think the reasonable thing and maybe the responsible thing for us to consider is what shall we do in the midst of this resurgence of the pandemic COVID virus? We've been asked by those outside this church what we thought, if indeed we would do this or that. I think the elders here have come to rest upon we need to emphasize love and unity of this body, and we need to be considerate of one another. And it's in that spirit that I would suggest to you this morning and ask of you this morning that you prayerfully consider the wearing of masks when you come into the building here and you are with people who are even greater risk and vulnerability than you might be, but that you express and you show respect and consideration for others by wearing a mask, if indeed that's called for by that person who is a matter of a real health concern. Singing is one of those things that we've been told gives us the greatest risk in projecting and sharing the feeling, the air within us, if you will. Mask is emphasized even more so in singing. Again, we would ask you to prayerfully consider where you are with respect to the wearing of masks as it relates to loving others. We have reason, I think, now with this pandemic resurgence, increased emphasis on distancing. We've enjoyed for a period of time now touching, shaking hands. We've enjoyed hugging, and we've talked about that some. Perhaps it's time that we be more cautious with our touching, the shaking of hands, the hugging. Perhaps it's time that we acknowledge that this thing is still with us. Let's not be fearful. Let's not be aggravated by anything that comes our way. Let's just be members of that body that Christ called us to be. I guess opportunity comes back to mind. Perhaps in this time of trial, this time of stress, perhaps this very stressful time to all of us is the time when God expects the best of us. And indeed, opportunities abound to reach out and touch someone else. And we would encourage you to do just that, that this is an opportunity. This too, God will help us through. A reference made to Paul's talking to the Corinthian church in a second letter, in chapter 1, I guess verses 7 or 8 and 9, somewhere along there. He says, "For we do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself." Times were tough. "Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead." Can we see the stress of all this pandemic and all this threat of virus? Can we see that as and certainly God knows what's going on, but is that not necessarily, in this line, something God knows and expects us to respond to in the way that we rely upon Him and not on ourselves? Perhaps that's an element that we don't often consider. These things may exist to bring us back, and hopefully we among all would learn the lessons that God intends for us to learn. There's a purpose, there's a calling, but the emphasis, I think, should not be on talking about the virus, but talking about the love and the unity, the things that we commonly would enjoy. God will help us with the stress, I'm confident. God has blessed this body, and I think God will continue to bless this body. We've seen increasing numbers of friends and family that have been touched by the virus, and we've been asked to pray. Last week was the time that we heard that two of our own members of the family here had tested positive to the virus. And we've had to make some changes, adjust our thinking to some extent. Joe has reported this and written to us in an email, more than one. Classes have been limited. We've suspended classes through the month of September for the most part. The auditorium class on Wednesday would continue for adults, and the youth will continue to have classes. But a lot of things that we had planned to do and were really excited about doing, we're going to have to suspend for a time. Increasingly, we hear these things coming back, and I have to acknowledge, let's not ignore it. Let's acknowledge the fact that this thing is still with us and that God will help us to steer through it. Let's be that church. Let's be that people that demonstrates to all our faith and our love, and let's grow through this experience. More might be said and probably needs to be said. If there are any questions, please talk with one of us as elders here, as shepherds here. Joe keeps pretty much in touch and will keep you informed. Things are going well with that family that's been touched by the virus lately. And we've had family members here that were touched earlier, infected, but thankfully fought the battle and won. We've been blessed, and God will continue to bless us and strengthen us, help us through these very things. And the purpose, if we listen to Paul, the purpose might be that we might depend upon God and not on ourselves. Probably that's enough said, and again, I may not have touched it all, but one of these elders that has had a part in these recent discussions might offer you something if you ask. We love you very much. We are concerned about you, and we want to protect as we can the unity of the body, that we might survive this and come out on the far end far stronger than we were going in. Prayer. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful this morning for the blessings that we see and all that you've done for us. We thank you for blessing us, each one of us, but this body of people throughout these last months. We thank you, Father, that you're always there, that you know clearly what's going on. Your purpose we hardly understand, and yet we acknowledge your purpose and your intent may well be in this process. Help us, Father, to accept your guidance and to look to you for that final guidance, that strength, the wherewithal to face these days that are tough, that are stressful, that cause us to act in such ways as you would not have us act. Bless us, Father, that we might preserve the unity here, that each one would see their place in this body is very, very critical to its continuance as a unified body of believers. Father, we ask you to intervene. We ask you to take control of this dreaded virus. It's your time, and in your wisdom, we ask you to intervene, to steer us through this, to eradicate completely this virus that has attacked so many. We ask you, Father, to bless those who now are infected by this virus, that indeed the treatment that's available to us might be successful, and that they might be restored to full health. We know, Father, that there are some who've lost loved ones, even as we talk about this dreaded virus. There are those who have lost loved ones. We ask you to bless them with comfort and peace and understanding, that even in the death of their own family members, they can look to you for that consolation and that peace. Bless us, Father, as we struggle day to day. Strengthen us, Father. Help us to endure what we must. But spare us the worst, we pray. Bless this church, Father, in every way, that the ministries that we have undertaken would be according to your will for us, that we might seek to serve your purpose in everything that we do, and that we might seek to glorify you and only you in our Lord Jesus. Forgive us, Father, where we've fallen short. Forgive us where we've sinned. Cleanse us and renew us. Create within us, Father, a pure heart. Restore to us the joy of your salvation. Draw us together, Father, and strengthen us that we might together deal with what we must hear. Bless us, Father, and help us to know that you're always with us, that we might experience your presence and your power in our lives, and that we might have your peace. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Please be standing.
I walk with the King,
I walk with the King
to heavenly land, the kingdom of light, the pathway of right, eternal His throne, forever 'twill be,
forever 'twill be,
to mansions on high. Crown there for me, I walk with the King, through pastures so green, by quiet waters still, to do His good will. He lighteth the way, from darkness to day. I walk with the
forth and bless someone this way.